Don't you just get the impression that NMR is really starting to show its stuff now? I mean, my goodness, all the different things that are happening. Oh, it's just exciting. Now, I've been looking forward to this module for quite a long time. This is always one of the highlights in the face-to-face class and now in the online version as well, because so much of the stuff is really starting to come together. And you're getting a good handle on these coupling patterns and realizing that they are living, breathing, visible, manifest quantum mechanics just staring us in the face. They're just astonishing to think about. Now, I do want to, I titled this one essentially Nuclear Coupling, the Bad, the Good, and the Beautiful, because I want to kind of walk you through a few examples of how beautiful these patterns can be, how useful, how good these patterns can be in helping us determine structure, but also, as with everything, how complicated and difficult they can be to work with as well. So we're going to begin there with some of the bad aspects of the coupling patterns and work our way down to just their stunning beauty. And our first example of difficulty is the molecule, the proton spectrum of cholesterol. It's a big molecule, steroid hormone, and if you look at that structure, there's a whole lot of hydrogens that are all going to have very overlapped chemical shifts. Look at all of these aliphatic hydrogens and cyclic hydrogens. And in fact, there's only one hydrogen near an oxygen. There's only one hydrogen as part of this alkene. All the rest is all going to be piling up somewhere between, you know, 1 and 2 or 3 ppm. It's going to be a mess. And in fact, it is. Here is the proton NMR spectrum of cholesterol. You look at that and your first instinct should be to go, ugh, ugh. And it is. It is very complex looking, and you can see there are, you know, not very many really pretty coupling patterns in here. But I do point out, even with a molecule as complex as this, there is a lot we can see fairly quickly. Over here, way on the upfield side, we see a couple of methyl group singlets. And sure enough, cholesterol has those. We see what seems to be a couple of methyl groups split into doublets. And sure enough, the structure of cholesterol would have those as well. We do see something down over 5 ppm, the hydrogen on the double bond likely. We see something around 3.5 ppm, this hydrogen here next to the OH, next to the alcohol group of cholesterol. If we focus in at that peak at 3.5, even it doesn't look very pretty. It kind of sort of resembles a septet, but it doesn't have the right appearance. The Pascal's triangle predictions of the peak heights doesn't seem to look right. And the spacings, it's just not as pretty as we would like to see. But this is where it's a nice way of trying to illustrate what's wrong with the spectrum. All right, it's not a good way to put it. There's nothing wrong with it, but where it gets complicated. And in order to show that, I've got my good friend here, the molecular model. Now, this is part of the cholesterol. I didn't build the whole thing, because that's a little difficult to deal with. But I want you to see, and we're going to do it as a close-up. And I know having myself in close-up is never such a good thing. But what I've marked here in red is the hydrogen, the OH group. This is the hydrogen on the carbon next to it. There's our friend at 3.5. And I'm just using these colors to represent the rest of the cholesterol molecule. Now look at this ring. It's a six-membered ring, but it ain't benzene. This thing is a cyclohexane-type ring. If you remember your organic chemistry, who remembers boats and chairs and chairs and boats and aqueles and exules and equatorials and all that fun stuff? This is a complicated system, and it's made more so in a big molecule like cholesterol. These cyclic systems can be notoriously difficult to look at in an NMR spectrum. With this big chunk of the molecule here, this thing isn't flexing, so the axials aren't becoming equatorial and the equatorials aren't becoming axial. It's kind of locked into place, and it's almost certainly somewhat distorted.
But I want to focus in on this one. This is the hydrogen right next to the OH group. You would look at it at the chemical structure and say, oh, look, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 hydrogens nearby. It ought to be a pentet. It sure as heck ain't a pentet, and here's why. The problem is, if this thing is not symmetric and not flexing, then it has four neighbors, none of which are equivalent. That means this proton is going to couple to this one differently from that one, even though these share the same carbon. One is axial, one is equatorial. One has a different dihedral angle than the other. These are going to couple different from those. This ring is not symmetric. This one's different from that one. In other words, it is maybe near four protons, but it's not near four equivalent protons. This thing ideally is going to be a doublet of doublets of doublets of doublets. Ooh, that is going to would be a really interesting pattern. Now, in reality, it's almost certainly even more complicated than that, because some of the chemical shifts of these will be very close to each other. Some of the coupling constants may be nearly the same. Some may be different. What I did is I went and I simulated the thing a little bit. I set it up where this one is at 3.5. The chemical shifts of the others are somewhere less than 2. It started screwing around with 4 different coupling constants. Now, I didn't spend hours and hours doing it, so it didn't take, you know, I have a kind of a cheap one, but notice the pattern here. It looks a lot like, you know, a crude septet. And in fact, I'm pretty certain that this is a reasonably accurate simulation of what's going on. The idea here simply is cyclic molecules like cholesterol, or even just a simpler derivative of cyclohexane, are often going to give complex, overlapping, difficult to interpret coupling patterns. Let's face it, they're going to be a mess. There are ways we can help try to simplify them, and sometimes homonuclear decoupling, and ways we can get around this mess. We'll see more of that in the next module. But despite all that, despite the fact we can't see, you know, just gorgeous doublets and triplets and quartets in here, that doesn't mean all of the other things we've learned about integrations, chemical shifts, counting carbons, depth spectra, all of that still works. And so never be intimidated by a complex coupling pattern, even if it's difficult to interpret. There are many instances when it happens. Cyclic molecules is definitely one of them. Another instance of complexity in coupling patterns is a molecule like this one. This is something called benzyl acetone, and here's its structure, and here's its NMR spectrum. And it doesn't look all that bad when you first glance at it, but I want to focus in on these two, on the two triplets here, the CH2 groups of this part of the molecule. Now, I want you to see that they do look kind of like triplets, but they don't look quite right. They seem to almost be kind of bending in or tenting in toward each other a little bit. You'll notice how the inner peaks are larger than the outer peaks. It is sometimes called the roofing effect. If you drew a straight line, they would meet kind of in a roof-like pattern. In reality, what this is something called the onset of second-order coupling effects. This happens whenever the chemical shift of two groups are very close to each other, and in fact on the same order of magnitude as the coupling constant. There's a kind of a cute little ratio that says, you know, delta V over J, and if that ratio is greater than 10, then you're probably going to get nice, pretty doublets, triplets, quartets, all the standard sort of things. If that ratio gets less than 10, and the smaller it gets, the more complex your patterns are going to get, the less first order, nice simple stuff, and the more second order type pattern you're going to get. Delta V, chemical shift difference. And in this particular example, at the two chemical shifts are fairly close to each other, and the coupling constant at approximately 7 hertz, that ratio is right on the border of transitioning between first order, nice simple stuff, and second order patterns.
in order to express this one a little bit better, I've run a few simulations as well, as this is really kind of convenient. What I did first is I set up essentially two CH2 groups, one at 2, one at 4 ppm. I didn't care about the rest of the molecule, and I gave them a standard 7 hertz coupling constant. Now, at 2 ppm and 4 ppm on our instrument, that means, you know, there's a difference in there of 2 ppm. At 400 megahertz per ppm, they're 800 hertz apart from each other. 400 hertz per ppm, they're 800 hertz apart from each other. 800 divided by 7, that is way over 10. That's over, you know, practically over 100. Classic first order behavior, and the simulation shows just absolutely, you know, stunning, exactly what you would expect, triplets. But watch what happens if you change the simulation and bring those two now much closer together. 3.8 ppm, 4.0 ppm. Now, the pattern is starting to show that roofing business again. The inner peaks are growing, the outer peaks are shrinking some. Bring them in closer together, 3.9 and 4.0 ppm. Now that ratio has fallen below 10, and we have a set of peaks here that are quite badly distorted. This is very definitely a much more second order, hard to interpret type pattern. And you know, this one is very common in the cyclic molecules. All those protons sitting there in cholesterol, they're all going to have chemical shifts at 2.1 and 2.2 and 2.3 and 2.05 and 2.15. They're all piled up together. So second order effects are just ripping through that thing. Even in a fairly, you know, simple structure like this, you can see it. It's even worse if you have a weaker magnet. You can run the same simulation, but only at 200 megahertz. Because you do realize at 200 megahertz, that delta V part is going to be cut in half. The coupling constant is still going to be 7 hertz. Look at the pattern now. It's not even quite recognizable as triplets anymore. And if you could simulate how it gets worse at a weaker magnet, you can also show how it gets better looking on a stronger magnet. Here it would be at 800 megahertz. This is one reason why NMR spectroscopists are always envious of a stronger magnetic field. It allows us to get nice first order coupling patterns, as the molecules we want to study are more complex and the coupling patterns potentially could get badly distorted, keeps them looking pretty despite how close the chemical shifts might get. Now, to be honest, something like cholesterol, even at 800 megahertz, is not going to be a trivial structure to examine. And finally, the other classic example of really molecules that can have quite complex coupling patterns, aromatic molecules. These flat benzene rings, they show a lot of the coupling patterns we might see. There's also what's called magnetic non-equivalence of your various protons. We're not going to dive deeply into that, except to say that it can complicate the coupling patterns you might see. And so aromatic regions are oftentimes we don't even bother to try to interpret them. We use them, oh, definitely use them. Their chemical shifts are so distinct, and the integrations can tell us whether it's, you know, substituted at one position or substituted at two positions and so forth. But we don't go through there and try to interpret, ooh, that's a doublet or a triplet very often. More often we say, oh, there's a complex aromatic region. It integrates to 5, so there's a singly substituted benzene ring in this molecule, and go on from there. They are complicated, but the chemical shifts are so distinctive, it makes them fairly simple to use. Now a quick example of some of the power of exploiting coupling patterns to learn about our molecules. Here's an NMR spectrum, and I'll show you what the molecule is in just a moment. The spectrum is a relatively simple one, it would seem. It has, you know, some standard components in there. Oh, look, there's an aromatic region. Looks kind of complex, but it integrates to nearly 5. A benzene ring with one substitution on it. Over here, two protons that seem to, you know, be in the, you know, around 5 to 6 ppm. Alkene, that would be really interesting, wouldn't it? In fact, if you zoom in on this, oh, a doublet of triplets. Oh, God, that's just beautiful. A double to triplets and an alkene. And then over here you see something over 4 ppm here. A hydrogen near an oxygen, like maybe an alcohol. And then there's this one singlet down here, fairly broad. D2O drop test shows that one is an OH peak. Ah, oh, man, we have an alcohol here. C8 integrate the protons at 4 point, you know, above 4 integrate to 2. So we have a CH2OH. Nice. And that CH2 group is a doublet. So there must be one proton on the carbon next door. And if you look carefully, it's not just a doublet, it's a doublet of doublets, with that second doublet coupling being really small, almost as if there's a long range coupling here, like a carbon with a hydrogen double bonded to a carbon with another hydrogen, and that would get us the long range, and then that to the benzene ring. My gosh, what a lovely little molecule that makes. And it is, it's called cinnamyl alcohol. It's actually a cinnamon derivative. Fairly basic molecule, fairly simple structure to get even just from the proton spectra. But you notice a key component there, the chemical shift of these hydrogens here next to the oxygen above 4, integrating to 2, so it's a CH2 group, and split into a doublet. So we know on the next carbon over, there must be one proton. Oh, it's just so beautiful. Excuse me. We've seen this thing before. This is the septet of doublets. Now, it comes from a molecule, an ingredient in peppermint. It's called menthol. Here's its structure. Ooh, it's a complex molecule. It has a cyclic, so it has all of its complexities you would expect from a molecule like this. But the septet of doublets, oh, that one is actually quite clear. You can kind of see it here. And if we look at the structure of menthol, it's this proton right here. I want you to notice carefully, it's next to 2 methyl groups, 6 protons, and then in the other direction, one more. It's next to 7 adjacent protons. That ought to make it an octet. It doesn't if the chemical, or if the coupling constants are different. The fact that it's a septet of doublets tells me that the coupling to the 2 methyl groups are equivalent, giving us the septet. But the coupling between this proton and its adjacent neighbor over here must be different, quite a bit smaller than the coupling constant back to the methyl groups. Septet of doublets. It's just one of the most lovely patterns to fall out of a complex molecule that you're ever going to see. It just It's just beautiful. It's just so much to go for. And finally, some examples of some absolutely beautiful coupling patterns. You've seen some of them already, though you may not have noticed them in spectra that we've looked at. Here is our dear friend methyl ethyl ketone. Gosh, we love that thing so much. Now, we talked in an earlier video about heteronuclear decoupling. The fact that you can actually observe the coupling of the hydrogens that are attached to carbons, causing the carbon to split into doublets or triplets or quartets, depending upon if it's a CH, CH2, or a CH3, and how we decouple that. So our carbon signals, which are going to be weak, are singlets and easier to observe. But it ought to work in the other direction, and in fact it does. Remember, if you look at it through the proton's perspective, 99% of the time, those protons are attached to a carbon-12, non-magnetic boring nucleus. But 1% of the time, those protons are attached to a carbon-13, one carbon-13. And therefore, every proton signal attached to a carbon ought to be attached to a carbon-13 ought to be split into a doublet. So here it is. Here's the methyl, the triplet methyl group of methyl ethyl ketone. You don't see a whole lot here, so what we're going to do is change the gain. We're going to jack up the Y value so that the tops of these peaks are, you know, up off the roof someplace. But look at the baseline. Look to the left and look to the right. Do you see other triplets showing up? There are other trace contaminants in here, but it's these two that are the critical ones, the ones evenly spaced around the big triplet. This is what is referred to as the carbon-13 satellites. This is the 1% of the protons attached to a magnetic C13. This is a doublet of triplets. Doublet because of the C13, triplet because of the neighboring protons. And in fact, you can even measure the distance between one part, you know, this doublet part and this one over here, and get the proton-carbon coupling constant. We saw that, you know, in the reverse direction when we looked at the coupled methyl ethyl ketone carbon spectrum. It's this quartet over here. Now we're looking at it from the perspective of the protons attached to C13s rather than the C13s attached to protons. It's just beautiful. Oh. We've seen deuterium have its, you know, have a little bit of fun with the C13s of deuterated chloroform. Ah, what about deuterated solvents that have methyl groups in them? Let's take a look at this for a moment. This is the carbon of deuterated acetonitrile, CD3CN. This is a carbon with three spin one deuteriums attached. It's a septet. Oh, and it's just a stunningly beautiful septet. Oh, I just love that pattern. I just want to stare at it for a while. Oh, but moving on, look at the proton spectrum. Now the proton spectrum is a little bit different because this one is CD2H, the 1% or less, the 0.1% of the deuterated acetonitriles that actually still have a hydrogen attached. And it's not CH3CN, it's CHD2CN. This is a proton near two spin one deuteriums. Gives a pentet pattern. Next, let's look at this stuff. This is the stuff, I bought this at Walmart a while back. It's one of those cans of stuff you use to spray dust out of your computer keyboard or something. A lot of people think that it's just a can of compressed air, but it really isn't. There's a liquid in there. And it's a molecule actually called difluoroethane. Fairly simple little molecule. Here's its structure. They use it because they can, you know, compress it into the liquid state. So there's a lot in here. They don't have to pressurize it all the way up to, you know, 20 or 30 atmospheres. Who cares about that? I want to look at the NMR spectrum of this thing. Because, oh my, here's the proton spectrum. Difluoroethane. It ought to be so simple. Look at this thing for a moment. You know what's going on here? Don't forget, fluorine is a magnetic nucleus, 100% abundant, spin one half. Those two fluorines are causing triplets. Oh my gosh. Both for the hydrogens, the hydrogen attached to the carbon, attached to the fluorines, chemical shift way down there, downfield, and the hydrogens on the methyl group near the fluorines. Just a stunning pattern. And then you look at the carbon. Ah, it's here again. Because after all, this is the fluorines are attached to carbons. This is not carbon, this is not the coupling we see to protons. This is a proton decoupled spectrum. The coupling you're seeing here, the splitting patterns you're seeing here in the carbons are due to carbon fluorine coupling. Splitting patterns in a carbon spectrum, dead giveaway that that molecule contains nuclei, especially if it's proton decoupled, nuclei that are magnetic and not proton. Fluorine or phosphorus are quite common in various areas of chemistry. Just a stunning pattern. And finally, the fluorine NMR spectrum. Yes, indeed, you can take one, and here it is. Isn't that just beautiful, the pattern that this thing made? Try as you might, you will never find a prettier doublet of quartets than this one, the fluorine spectrum of difluoroethane found in a can of compressed, you know, dust remover bought at Walmart. Give me a moment. I was helping one of my other colleagues, actually fairly recently, Dr. Amanda Stewart, and some of her students get some NMR spectra. And one of the compounds she was working with was actually an ionic compound. It dissolved nicely in, I think, DMSO, dimethyl sulfoxide deuterated version. She was interested in the proton and the carbon spectra, but when she told me about the structure, it was the anion that struck me. It was hexafluorophosphate, PF6. PF6, two magnetic nuclei we don't normally see together in one species. And I thought, oh, holy sweet Jabba the Hutt, this is going to be a fun one. So I took a little bit of this stuff, with her kind permission, and ran a fluorine and a phosphorus NMR spectrum on it. Here is the fluorine spectrum. No surprise here, really. These are fluorines. They have an odd chemical shift. It's something we don't see very often. We don't do fluorine that often, but here it is. Each of these fluorines are attached to a phosphorus, spin 1/2 nucleus, 100% abundant. A doublet, just a beautiful, stunning doublet. Measure the coupling constant. That is an enormous coupling constant here, over 700 hertz coupling. They are very close to each other. Each is extraordinarily proximate to the other, and they are generating quite strong magnetic fields. You thought that was stunning. Look at this one. This is the phosphorus spectrum. This is a phosphorus with 6 fluorines attached to it. 6 100% abundant spin 1/2 fluorines. The phosphorus fluorine septet. Look at that thing. Each branch of the septet separated from the others by over 700 hertz coupling. We see the same coupling constant when we measure it either in the fluorine or in the phosphorus spectrum. It is just a gorgeous pattern. Okay, I'm okay. Living, breathing quantum mechanics. The coupling patterns, they can be complicated. We understand why it happens, when it happens, and we will learn other techniques in the next module of how to get around it sometimes. But we don't let it get us down. We can handle it, get around it. They can tell us an enormous amount of information about the groups nearby, and they will do even more in the next module. And yeah, I've been exaggerating perhaps, but really not that much. They are beautiful to look at. They are stunning, stunning examples of the quantum mechanical nature of nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. It shows itself over and over and over again, and the results are lovely to look at.